Do other people hear the background noise that I hear?
Yes, I hear that as well. It's coming from Gustavo. I can mute him. All right. So we are now live. We're going to wait a little bit to let people sign in, though, but this will be the start of the recording. So just to acknowledge the people who will be listening later on, I'm going to go make sure that people in the chat rooms know about it. Matthew, can you say something?
Yes, I can say something.
Okay, so we have one viewer who is testing right now. It is Sam.
Okay.
He says he doesn't hear anything, but maybe that's because we weren't saying anything.
Okay, does he hear anything now?
Oh, he says now it's going. Okay, so great. Sam can hear now. Very good. So our most important listener is here. All right, we got two more viewers. We're still, you know, a minute ahead of schedule, so we got a little time. Load up the QA app. Very good. So we have a first question, Peekaboo. Okay, so we're currently answering Matthias's Peekaboo. Very good. So we've tested the QA app. Okay, so we've got five more viewers. Let's wait just a little bit longer. It is now actually noon.
Did we get Gustavo set up where he's in control of the mute now?
He should be.
Okay. Gustavo, can you say something just to make sure?
Gustavo, can you say something?
Hello?
Very
okay,
good.
Good.
Okay, so just unmute yourself as you need to ask something.
Okay.
Very good. So I think we have a quorum now. So let me just... All right, so welcome to the second Inside Racket seminar. This time we'll have Matthew Flatt, who will be talking about the Racket bytecode compiler. So Matthew is Mr. Racket, obviously, so he needs no introduction. Also on this call with me is Gustavo Massacesi. I think is how you say your name, Gustavo. Gustavo has made quite a few contributions to the bytecode compiler, and he is probably going to be a much better foil than me looking at this code and trying to understand it. Just a little bit of a reminder about what the purpose of the Inside Racket seminar is. The idea is that you know, Racket is a large, complicated piece of technology, and while the documentation talks about how to use it, it's a little bit more complicated. Purposes, we want to have these little seminars where we can go really deep into how something works, and give the give people in the community opportunity to learn about it and ask questions. So today will be our first one about the virtual machine, specifically on the bytecode compiler. So with that introduction, I'll let Matthew give any introduction he wants and start taking it away.
Yeah, I guess the introduction is to point out that the replacement for this compiler is already under development by Leaf, which begs the question why we're looking at this old version if we hope that it goes away. And part of it is we don't know how fast it will go away. Another part of it is to make sure that Leaf, as a developer of the replacement, knows all the pieces that are already there and kind of the capabilities of the current bytecode compiler. But also for those who aren't writing a replacement compiler, this sort of provides a lower bound on the functionality of the compilers going forward and may give you some insight on what you can rely on the compiler to do.
That sounds great. So let's get started.
Okay, so here, hopefully you can see this diagram of the current compiler structure. So on the left, we have syntax objects coming in. Then you see there's purple arrows and orange arrows going through the rest of the pipeline. So there's two different representations. The compiler and expander front end produces something, produces a set of structures that we'll call the intermediate representation. And then the orange arrows, those are on the same representation that the bytecode interpreter and the evaluator, the JIT, the form that shows up in ZO. That's what the ZO parse library is able to deal with. So the purple thing, the purple part, is purely internal. And really, there's not a lot of difference between the purple and the orange. The main difference is how local binding is handled. In the intermediate representation, each local binding corresponds to a variable object, and references just share that same object, so that information about the variable is stored right in the object. Whereas bytecode at runtime, then there's a runtime stack, and variables are represented by static distances into that. Right.
I suppose that you'll get into it a little bit more, but what is the, I mean, what's the value in getting that second thing, just for, you know, stating the obvious?
Why have the orange representation different from the purple?
Yeah, exactly. Why is it valuable to have that static distance?
Yeah, that was, as we'll see throughout the compiler structure, a lot of it has to do with what seemed like a good idea for an interpreter at the time, 18 or however many years ago, 20 years ago. So, you know, you don't want names at runtime. You just want to go right to the variable. And since local bindings are stored on the stack, then a static reference into the stack is a typical thing that you compile to. And for surprisingly a long time, the purple also used a static distance offset into a stack, which was really a pain for the optimizer. We finally fixed that just recently. Did that answer the question?
Yeah, definitely.
Okay. So let's go into these pieces a little bit more. Actually, I should mention there's one more block. There's an unresolver that takes things back from orange back to purple. And I'll say a little bit more what that's for and where that came from. We're going to spend most of today, you know, diving through the C code that currently implements the compiler. Obviously, the replacement is being implemented in Racket, but what we've got is in C. And so those names at the top are some of the files, the main files that we will look at. The compile and expand box is there, and it's larger and kind of in two pieces because the compiler front end and the macro expander work together, and they're fused. You could reasonably expect that the pipeline would be take syntax objects and fully expand them and then start compiling them. And that's how future compilers will work, I imagine. But the way it is now, they're sort of interleaved and implemented together. If you just expand, then the compile part is ignored. If you just compile, then some work that the expander would do to reconstruct an expression is just skipped. And so fusing them maybe makes it a little faster. At least that was the theory once upon a time. So the front end is going to take syntax objects, produce this intermediate expression that's not so different from the core language. It's going to record information about bindings, such as whether they're mutated, how many times they're used, whether they're used only in application positions, or maybe used in application positions except one time, or something like that. And it's also going to, when you import bindings from other modules, record information about what it knows about those bindings, if it's a function, if it's a structure, selector, or something like that.
A little bit of a question about that. Would you say that the main thing that's happening is compilation and expansion happens as a side effect of that, or is it the main thing that's happening is expansion? Like, when I go look at this code, do I have to say what's happening is expansion and then compile time work is also happening? Or, you know, do you know what I'm trying to say?
Yeah, and I think it's sort of half and half, really. Both of those parts are about the same. You would think that the expander is more work. But the compiler does a little bit more to kind of catch up, especially in sanitizing let recs and lets and so on.
I see.
So it's hard to see it as either mainly one or the other.
Okay, great.
And that's why they're kind of woven together. I'll also note that compile is a terrible name. It's really just the front end of the compiler. But historically, what started out is the only thing. So it's all the names will still say compile, including the file name.
Sure. And so just to clarify a little bit there, the intermediate representation is not fully expanded code. Like, when we look up in the documentation, we sort of think, well, I've got my racket program, and that turns into fully expanded. That goes to the compiler. Intermediate is not fully expanded code. It's some other thing that happens on the fully expanded code.
That's right. It's very similar to fully expanded code, but just one step further towards bytecode.
Sure, great.
Yeah, and we'll look in more detail at what those forms are. But just to continue with the overview, after doing that first front end to get it into an intermediate expression, there's a let rec checking pass. This was by Claire Alvis. So this does a sort of abstract interpretation of your program to decide which variables are definitely going to be initialized before they're referenced. And if that's not the case, like for x, then it'll wrap it in a function call, check not unsafe undefined, because not initialized corresponds to an internal unsafe undefined. And that means later passes don't really have to worry about this. This function, built-in function check not unsafe undefined, isn't something that can be optimized away or necessarily reordered. And so for the most part, the rest of the compiler doesn't have to worry about it. The next step is optimize. And it's a kind of monolithic optimizer that does the usual things you would expect for a high-level language. It does inlining, constant propagation. It does not do common sub-expression elimination. I think that's the only common, you know, typical thing that it doesn't do. And I think it's because we just haven't found enough use for that yet.
Sure. Can we back up one box for a sec?
Sure.
Leif asked the question, when the compiler gets to the let rec pass, at that point, has it been totally fully expanded and there's no more syntax work going to happen?
That's right. By the time you get out of the compile slash expand box, all the macros are gone. There may be syntax literals to carry through all the way to bytecode, but no further macro level expansion is going to happen.
Okay, great. So for instance, like, you know, %app is not, like, this really is an honest to goodness function call. Nothing from the original program can change that check not unsafe undefined, etc.
Yeah. That's right. At this point, it is, that's kind of changing X to check not unsafe defined. It's not really an S expression thing. It's really at the AST level.
Yeah, okay, great.
This intermediate AST.
Okay, sorry to interrupt. Let's jump back in.
Not at all. So the optimizer, the only other thing I wanted to mention is, especially thanks to Gustavo, there is an increasing amount of local flow type inference in that optimizer box. So for example, if the source program had something like and pair question mark car, then at the AST level in this intermediate representation, the optimizer will tend to change that to, of course, the and is long gone, but something equivalent to, since I have already checked that it's a pair, then I can use unsafe car instead of car. Or if it had been cooter and then car, of course, similarly it would be unsafe car. Okay, so inlining is almost the most important optimization. It's probably the most important optimization, but another performance, perhaps even more important thing for performance, happens in the resolve phase. So after the optimizer has rewritten everything, the resolve phase is responsible for closure conversion. In particular, if you have something like a for list under this make list, where you know this is expanding to a recursive function call and v would be in the closure, this is going to get converted to not allocate a closure at runtime. there will be the actual function that gets produced will take an I, and will also take a V to carry it through. We'll see that that's really the most complicated part of this resolver pass. Otherwise, it's just converting variables into the static coordinates the way you would expect. The SFS pass happens after that, and this is just kind of fixing up the lifetimes of some variables to ensure that it's safe for space. So for example, if you have if your original program had something like let x be make a big value based on y, and then we're going to filter on x and condense y somehow, maybe filter returns something much smaller than x, and so x should not stay live when you do the condense y part. If you used a continuation passing style intermediate form, then that would just sort of happen by using pruning the environment enclosures. But because this is actually going to turn into something like x on a runtime stack, then SFS inserts right here between these, or actually just before it calls filter, it zeroes out the storage for the x variable. Right, so it's a small pass, but needed to make things safe for space. Finally, the unresolver, which goes backwards. One of the main uses of the unresolver is for cross-module inlining. So compile records information that the implementation of this imported function is here. And the unresolver is what actually rewinds it so that it can be inlined and fed back into the optimization phase. This was mostly written by Blake Johnson, and his interest was flattening out modules and then re-optimizing them. But it started from a kind of primitive rewinding for inlining, and this could actually go a little further, maybe to do some partial evaluation that may or may not happen. So that's the overview.
So now that we've got this overview, could you just comment very briefly? So Scott Moore asked this question. You know, what's the motivation for the rewrite? If we were to look at this, this diagram right here, do we want to get rid of all the things that you've listed and port those into Racket, or are there only certain things? And what is the reason really for that?
So the reason for the rewrite is mostly the .c right here to make it .rkt. But also this optimizer is a monolithic optimizer, and the rewrite Leaf is using nanopass structure that you can make it much more maintainable, have much more control over passes, have more flexibility in ordering different passes instead of making one pass that has to be carefully balanced. Gustavo might comment on this, but you know, it's sometimes kind of hard. You know that this optimization might happen, then you could do this other optimization, but because they're in the wrong order, then you sort of duplicate a kind of transformation and make it happen earlier so that something else can happen later. So that, I think, is just abstractly why you would want to rewrite things a motivation, and the bigger motivation is the .c.
Okay. And so, I mean, obviously we like to change things to .racket for puritanical reasons, but it sounds like the main thing is the maintainability.
Yes, maintainability. Yep.
And now, is it that, we sort of center our concern on the optimizer, but of course, does that mean that we have, you're going to have to get rid of these other pieces from the .c as well? Or is it, can we sort of surgically go in and just change, let's say, the purple stuff?
We have focused on this, but really the kinds of things that you want to do, this is just a pass, and this is a pass, and this is a pass. So those fit into a more general framework, and there's no reason these things have to be in this particular order. Like, it's possible that let rec checking could do a little bit better if there were certain optimizations that happened earlier. Then it would discover that variables are not referenced too early. In that particular case, I'm not sure it would actually happen, but that's an example of things.
Okay, great.
So let's start going through these pieces now, and shift to this view here. And let's start out by looking at what are actually the intermediate forms. So in Racket, different at the C level in the Racket runtime system, things that you would imagine as being different structs at the surface level, or different primitive data types. Each of them has a different tag. So the runtime bytecode, everything that's not a literal value is one of these things. So top level, as you see top level, you should think variable defined at the top of a module or outside of a module. When you see local, you should think let bound or lambda bound. Local unbox means that it's mutable, and so using it has to unbox it. application is a function call, of course. And the reason there are three variants is because functions with just one argument or functions with just two arguments are very common, and so having a specialized representation makes it more compact at runtime. You will see that the intermediate form used by the optimizer still has three different variants, which is not a good idea. It's another holdover from not having the intermediate representation at one point. So if the code turns out to be long-lived, then that's a good place to simplify the intermediate representation. Just use the application type.
So
I should say...
Question. Sorry. This idea that, okay, here's this thing later on that we could potentially clean up, we would expect that those are the sorts of things that you'll try to do, that you and Leaf will try to do when you do the rewrite. Do you expect that, overall, this is the rewrite will have a performance boost, or will it be more really focused on that maintainability? One way I could think about it is maybe the compiler might run a little bit slower, but it will be a better compiler, so ultimately Racket programs would run better.
Yeah, I'm not sure. My current sense is that it's more of the runtime system that's the next limiting factor for performance. But I would be happy to be wrong about that as a new compiler comes online.
Okay, great.
Certainly, the new compiler wouldn't bother with this in the intermediate format. It would split things out at the very end into the different application types.
Okay.
Also, I've kind of gone back and forth between saying the intermediate representation and the bytecode. A lot of these are the same, but some of these will swap out in the intermediate, as I'll get to in a minute. But it happens that those three are the same. These three, it turns out, are not in the intermediate form. Sequence means begin. Branch means if. Lambda means lambda. That's a recent improvement to actually use lambda. Let value and let void. These work together. So the way the bytecode form works, and there is a paper you can go read about this in more detail, but let void make some space on the stack, and let value actually installs things into space that's already made, as does let rec. So this let rec is function-only let rec. You have a set of mutually potentially recursive functions. Let value is sort of an arbitrary setbang of some space that's been made, although the setbang may be purely internal, right? If it's a variable that you can't see before it's initialized. And then let one.
Oh, sorry, go ahead about let one.
Yeah, just to finish up with let one, it's a specialization of let void and let value for a single variable that is not mutable.
Okay. So a little bit of question about these various kinds of let, and this is mainly from Leaf. So there's all these different there's all these different kinds of lets. Is it that there's different phases of the compiler where, you know, at the beginning everything says let rec and you discover certain things aren't functions, so you use the other ones, then later on you discover it's a let one? Or are these really the expander creates these kinds of things?
No, it's actually going to turn out to be that the things start out as kind of let or let rec, but get refined as you go. So the optimizer might discover that a let rec can be simplified, or the optimizer may have to keep things in a big chunk, and then the resolver says, ah, I see. Now that things have been optimized and cleaned up, I can see that here's a set of functions that are recursive, and there's some constants defined before and some other things after, and it sorts them all out.
Okay.
So in fact, you start out with let and let rec only, and they get refined to these lower level kinds of things.
Okay, so from one perspective, maybe like because of the way that it's written, it would be way too complicated to actually have different IRs. So there's almost these little annotations on the types in your brain about, okay, these ones are from this phase of the compiler, these ones are from that one.
Sort of. It would be tempting to think that this is one kind of let and this is another kind of let, but really this is kind of a header for setting up a sequence of these and these. So the naming convention could be much better. It's actually slightly better in the IR.
Okay.
So again, this is setting up, I'm going to bind a bunch of stuff, make some room for it, and this is filling in some of those, and this is filling in some of those. Whereas this one really is a kind of fusion of those. This one is make some space and bind it right away, fill it in right away.
Okay.
With continuation mark, needs no explanation, quote syntax is again syntax literals. And then these in a different group are just sort of the bigger structuring things. So define values at the top level, define syntaxes at the top level or a module, begin for syntax. Setbang, this is really, by the time you get to the bytecode, setbang only for top level things, module and top level things, because if you're setting a local, this actually, we just reuse let value for that. Boxenv is when you've bound a variable, but it needs to be mutable later, so it sort of changes a local variable from immutable to mutable. Begin zero. Splice is like begin at the top level, but it does different things with the prompt requires for top level. Varref is hash% variable reference. All right, and then these are sort of, these two are runtime forms that don't have a direct surface syntax. So this is a particular use of call with values will turn into apply values if the compiler knows that it doesn't need some of the closures. Similarly, with immediate mark is at the surface language call with the immediate continuation mark, where the compiler wants to arranges to avoid a closure allocation. Case lambda is case lambda. Module is module. An inline variant is something that has two lambdas inside of it, one of which is used directly when running the module, and the other one is used for potential inlining sites for importing modules. So it's just a hint where the compiler can generate a kind of small version of the function that might be inlineable, and one that's more suitable if it's not going to be inline, that can have a lot more inlining locally.
Can you hold on just 1 sec? Someone asked a question about the varref. So Scott Moore says, what is variable reference? I've encountered it before, but I'm not really sure.
It's kind of, you can think of it sort of like ampersand in C on global variables. It gives you a handle on the variable itself. And actually, we use it most for a handle to the namespace that the variable resides in.
So I'm a little bit surprised, actually, that this is not something that is only in the syntax expander, that it really does have to show up in there.
Yeah, it's a sort of fundamental runtime thing to be able to grab the current namespace or to grab the address, if you will, of a variable, the identity of a variable.
Okay.
And then here are...
Sorry, okay. Just one more thing about that inline variant. So the inline variant, I mean, does everything get an inline variant? Is that like something that's been defined at the top level is going to get one of these? This is a little bit, Spencer has a question, when the compiler is running to produce, code for that's going to go in a ZO versus in the JIT, will it do different things? And is this kind of a little hint to that?
This only happens in modules, and you see it when you decompile a module. It only happens for some of the definitions in a module. So if you use the decompiler on a module, you might see hash% inline variant in the decompiled form, which is just a made-up thing for decompiling. And so it shows you the two forms that it has. So it's not for every definition. It's only where the module part of the optimizer thinks that it has a function that's a good candidate for cross-module inlining.
I see. And then on that other question about whether, when we get into the compiler, are we going to see anything different that says, this is for ZO, this is for running right now? There's just one compiler, right?
There's just one compiler. I'm not sure what you mean.
So what I mean is that if we know that we're doing ahead of time compilation, maybe we'll invest more time versus jitting right now.
Oh, I see. So the JIT is, there's two compilers in that sense. So the JIT works on bytecode. And the compiler, there's just one compiler in the sense it's not doing anything different based on whether it's going to ZO or whether it's going to go straight off to the JIT or whether it's going to go to the bytecode evaluator, bytecode interpreter directly.
Great.
Not quite true, but close enough for today's purpose. The not quiteness has to do with top levels. It just sort of, there's a shortcut to avoid relinking global variables.
Okay.
So these are the ones that are different in the intermediate representation. So locals, that's the key one, of course. Instead of a static coordinate, then that's a object. Lambdas are a little bit different because we need a little different information at intermediate time. Let is completely different. So let header is a generic header that says I'm going to set up. It's a lot like let void, but it's setting up make space for this many variables and this many clauses, but it has a flag on it that says I am a let rec or I am a let. And then let value is really one of those clauses in a let or let rec. So again, not so great named. Let clause would have been, I should have renamed that recently actually to make it let clause. So let header together with a sequence of let values is a let or let rec. And then top level unquote syntax, they're slightly different in the intermediate representation. And then everything after that is just runtime values.
So Sam asks a question. Sam says, you know, what's this weird editor that we're looking at? He's just very curious about this.
Oh, it's a variant of Dr. Racket or the editor classes that is just streamlined for my presentation today.
Okay.
Emacs
naturally, you know. So naturally, Matthew would write a whole editor just for a presentation.
Yeah, yeah. That makes it easier.
Okay, sorry to interrupt.
So if there are no more questions on this, then we will start jumping into the compiler proper. All right.
I think maybe one question is appropriate at this time. Leaf says, you know, this bytecode representation, is it easy to JIT or is it hard to JIT?
It's pretty easy to JIT. It's easy to directly take this and generate machine code. That's not necessarily the ideal JIT. In particular, our JIT doesn't try to do any register allocation. It just uses the stack, as you say, except that, you know, the hottest one or two things in the stack might still be in a register somewhere, and it pays attention to that. So it is, I think mainly the answer is yes, this is easy to JIT.
Okay, good. Okay, so let's move on.
Okay. Let's see. So here's our first ugly-looking function, compile k. So if you start evaluating something in Racket, then it'll probably come into compile k, and there's a bunch of setup here. You know, you can see thing, it's checking whether you want constants to be enforced and so on. And we get down to the main while loop, because you might be at the top level, splicing a begin. We set up this compilation environment. So this
Hold
is
on.
What the front end.
I feel like I just missed something. This is a really scary function. It just its signature was void.
Yes, right.
So
So all the arguments here are the real arguments right here. They were passed through the current threads object, kind of like parameters. And this is just a avoiding Stack Overflow kind of issue.
I see.
So the real arguments are the syntax that you're going to compile and run. Well, compile. Maybe run. If it's for a val, you're going to run it. GM here, env typically means namespace in the C level. So that's the namespace that we're running in. This writable is this minor hint that we briefly touched on. Whether it's going to ZO or not, it'll do something slightly different. So writable means can be written to ZO.
Yep.
And top intro is a macro thing. It says, should I apply the namespace?
And just a little bit more about the fact that the arguments are there and this ends in dash and underscore k. You know, the C code has this whole model of, you know, a preemption point could have happened at any time. So periodically, certain pieces of the C code sort of volunteer that they can be interruptible. And what they do is they save their state into this object for the current thread so that later if the thread restarts, it'll grab it, figure out what function it is supposed to call, and then we'll come back into here. Is that correct?
Yeah, in this particular case where these variables are set and extracted, there's no thread swaps in between. But that is a kind of thing that happens. I think, let's see, compile should just be right down here. Yeah, so here's the normal way it's called, and this is just packing it up and jumping to compile t with a sort of make the stack nice. Scheme top level do really means make the stack nice and handle Stack Overflow. Set up to handle Stack Overflow.
Okay.
So with the lack of, another way to look at this is compile would be a closure, and this is what we want in the closure because we're passing it to this higher order prepare to handle Stack Overflow function.
I see. Okay. It's almost like a C version of apply.
Yeah, right. Actually, I didn't intend to talk about any of this stuff, but this is what it looks like to set up the expander and compiler, and then the main thing that happens is that in here it's mixed up with the splicing, but scheme compile expr, that's going to use the front end, do macro expansion, and get this intermediate form out as O.
Okay.
So the key result of all this while nested stuff, handling macros and lifting of a macro, you know, if you call syntax local lift require or something like that. That's what that loop is doing. But ultimately, you get an O back, and then we pass it off to the let reg check pass. And then we set up sort of a record for optimization, and we pass it off to the optimize pass. And then we resolve some information about top levels and syntax, and we pass it off to the resolve pass, and then the SFS pass, and then we clean up the information about the top levels just a little bit more, and then we have something that we can evaluate. So it gets wrapped up in this scheme compilation top thing, and that's the kind of thing that gets marshaled into a bytecode, into a ZO file. And then there's a flag that you
can... So this really is the diagram that you showed us earlier.
This is the diagram, right? This is the semicolon form of the row of boxes that we had before.
Great.
Right. And sadly, this happens a couple of places, three maybe, because slightly different things happen in between. Some different flags get set. It would be better to refactor this and have that pipeline actually in one place, or at least the rest of it, because the way you get to the initial compiler can be different. Okay, so yes, the main point here was just to show you that the pipeline looks like that. So we can look at the front end a little bit. Compile expands expert, so that name is because the compiler and the expander are tangled together, and this is sort of the zine dispatch on an expression. The other dispatches are going to be...
Hold on, Matthew, I think we've lost your audio for a sec.
Okay. Can you hear me now? Testing 1, 2, 3.
Yeah, we've lost your audio for a second, Matthew. Can you check your microphone, maybe?
Let's see, did that help at all?
It started going buzzy, and then after it was buzzy, it then just dropped off.
I see. Is it, and it's not back yet? Robbie says it's better now. Is that true? Can you hear me?
So some people say that it's better now.
What I can do, if I switch to this, is that better? Or is that worse? Can people hear me now?
Although I personally cannot hear anything.
Robbie, is it better for me to use the mic or not use the mic? But it's worrying that Jay can't hear anything. It is true. Hmm. Yeah. Okay. I will leave it like that if this is good enough. But Jay still can't hear me, right? So Jay still can't hear me? Everyone else can? Have we resumed any better? Yeah, but how about now? Am I back?
I think we're back.
Okay. Sorry about that. Do other people think we're back?
Yes, I think so.
Okay. Where were we?
We were you were just about to move beyond the box.
Right, okay. So we're looking at the compile front end. And I was saying that other mean expr dispatcher functions are gonna look the way you would expect. There's a case for all the different variants that we just looked at. Scheme, top level, type, and so on. But the compiler being the macro expander, it's the dispatch works differently. So I'm going to close Slack. Okay. In the right place. Okay. So this dispatch really is set up a different way, because what you're seeing here is look up a variable that's not after a parenthesis and handle macro expansion if it's a variable expander, or handle macro expansion if it is after a parenthesis, and so on. So it ends up really dispatching to the expander or compiler this way through this indirect function call here. Right. So that was all to say you didn't really want to look there. Instead, you might want to look at things like quote and if, those bindings from the kernel module. It says quote is primitive syntax that has this compiler and this expander. So depending on whether we're trying to just expand or whether we're trying to compile, we'll go to these two different functions. So let's look at this. If we go to quote expand doesn't really do much. It takes its form and it returns its form. Whereas the quote compile takes the form and then, well, just turns it back to a datum, and it's a quoted piece of data. How about, let's look at lambda. Where's lambda?
So just to make sure I understand this a little bit, you know, when we looked at that dispatch expression function, we might have expected to see something, we might have expected to see everything that's listed in the fully expanded code there, you know, saying, oh, is it this thing, is it that thing? But that's not how it works. It's,
right.
It's maybe more general and beautiful that there's this other list somewhere of here are the things that could appear. And when you see those, they have their own little compile functions, which we're looking at right now.
Exactly. So this is saying the binding of quote is primitive syntax that has this compiler and this expander. Right? And the binding of lambda is going to be this thing, which has this compiler and this expander. So the expand for lambda checks that it has the right form and puts it back together in the end after expanding the body. So you see, where do you see that? Checking the args, where is expanding the body? Oh, way down here. So it's expanding the body right there and then putting it together into a lambda. Whereas the compile variant of this checks the arguments and then makes a lambda form. Where I make lambda form does more work to set up the make these variable objects, compiles the body sequence, and puts it together into one of these RTIR lambda info. Sorry, actually, I wanted to show you that it makes a scheme IR lambda type, but that record has an extra little record hanging off of it, which is some runtime information. So let's go look at that, actually. Let's look at two things. So scheme lambda, this is the intermediate representation of a lambda. It has the number of parameters. It has the max lux depth, which is not actually used in the intermediate variant. That's for the bytecode variant. It has a closure size, which again really is the bytecode variant. But then at runtime, we need a mapping of coordinates as they exist when you see lambda and as they want to be accessed inside the lambda. But at compile time, in the intermediate form, then we have this IRO info. So it's just reusing the same structure for really two different things, the intermediate lambda and the bytecode lambda. We've got the body, we've got the name, and information about the top levels that are actually used. And then some extra stuff if we have the JIT to tie together the JIT and bytecode worlds.
So that TL map is kind of, you know, what the free variables function might return?
Yes, that's right. Free. Actually, does the free variables function tell you about module and top level things? This is only module and top level things.
Oh, I see.
Whereas this map is going to be the local bindings.
I see.
So closures in the runtime system are flat closures almost. There are two levels, local bindings and top-level module bindings, sort of a two-layer thing. And everything in the same module shares the same top-level and global thing, except that TL map tells the GC when it can actually prune some of those away.
And just one more question about those two expand and compile functions. Does the compile function get the result of the expand function, or are do they both look at the same?
They both look at the same thing. So when the let's see, where do we deal with the body again here? So when we do compile sequence, that's actually expand and compile the body of the function.
Oh, I see.
Yeah. So there's redundancy all the way through in these two paths.
Okay.
Or at least the compiler is always using the expander side. For the non-primitive things.
Okay.
And then this was that IR lambda info. Let's look at that real fast. That has So base closure means the variables that are captured. We're going to compute that later by the lambda. This is an array of pointers to those local objects. So these are the arguments. These are argument types that we accumulate. That's part of the flow type-ish inference system. And this is keeping track of whether we've seen all the calls. So if we know a function is only, if a variable is bound to a lambda, and that variable is only used in application positions, then we sort of keep track of whether all of those application positions have checked in for optimization so that we know how complete the argument type information is. Finally, we keep track of whether it's referring to globals, has non-leaf, is sort of knowing whether it's a leaf function or does it just only call a leaf function, which means it just uses primitives and returns, or calls other things. IsDupe is for the optimizer to track whether it can keep inlining things or whether this function has already been duplicated. Body size and body B size have to do with estimates for inlining. Let's pop a few layers out, unless there are questions there. Okay.
I think we're good.
So we looked how the compiler sort of gets going. We looked at how these primitive things are registered. We looked at lambda as an example for compilers, for compiler parts. Let's look at let and let rec handling. At every stage of the compiler, this is more interesting than you would like it to be. So there's extra complexity here that this is the sync for when you have an internal definition context, when you have let value, let rec syntaxes plus values, when you have let syntaxes, let rec values, and when you have let values, let star values is not primitive, it's expanded away, but let values and let rec values are primitives. So all of those things are going to come into here, and that's why there's so many arguments, because it's handling all of them. There's even kind of a leftover multi, because it used to be that let as well as let values were primitives, but multi is going to be always true, and we should clean up this things a little further to exploit that fact. So this is, you know, looking at all the right left-hand sides, looking at the names, making sure that they're all distinct, collecting them up, setting up a compilation frame that says these are the bindings at this level, so that references in the body or on the right-hand sides can be mapped back to there. It is doing more of those kinds of pieces that I just described, and also if it's not recursive, this is where we compile the right-hand sides. On the other hand, if it is recursive, then we just remember the names, and then we'll have another pass down below for the recursive case to finish the right-hand sides. So, you know, let and let rec are similar but not quite, and so you see that in this code that it sometimes does things in a different order depending on which of those it is. This is where we're making the arrays variables for every clause in the binding. This is where we make that header that says this is a group of clauses. And then this is, from an optimization perspective, the interesting part here, where it's looking and it says, okay, we're if recursive, so we're in a let rec. Do we really need it to be recursive? And this, again, is happening not just for where you wrote let rec or let rec values, but where you had an internal definition context, where in particular you don't necessarily really want let rec. If you said define x is 5, define y is 7, and so on, you want that to be like let x is 5 and let y is 7.
Yeah, so this is, you might think of this as, you know, because we've generalized, we now want to make it specific again because it's really bad for performance to always have that let rec.
That's right. So this is our first line of defense, our first pass at sorting that out. And so as it's compiling and expanding, it's keeping track of which variables are referenced. And basically, if you've gotten, if you've processed one and there were no references later or something, then you know that it can be peeled off into its own let or its own let rec. Right? So not only do you want to sort out the let rec and the lets, you want to make the let rec groups as small as possible. So that's what all of this is doing. So what we get out at the end is this header, which here's where we're removing the let recursive. So here's a case where we found a set of bindings that can be grouped together in just a let. So we make this you know, we adjust the header to say, no, it's not a let rec, it's a let, and we've made a new header for the remaining ones if necessary.
So now that we've seen this whole function, let's Matthias asked the question, why are these functions so large?
Because they're badly written. Yeah, they should be broken out into smaller functions, smaller steps. And some recent changes have moved in that direction, but not all. Part of the reason it's even worse at the C level when I write the code is that there are no closures, right? So you have to pass so many arguments along and get so many results back through indirections that it's often not very fun. But that's not an excuse for a lot of this code. It could be easily improved.
But definitely some of it is probably necessary. And then, you know, you do mention that you can't have closures, but we saw this a little bit earlier, you know.
Yeah, you don't have convenient
closures. Of the flow type. Those were scheme objects. So, I mean, one of the things to understand about the C code, if I understand correctly, is that we're really looking at C code that's using the scheme library to make C-style scheme code.
Yeah, to a large extent. So this is C code that's all garbage collected. You may have seen some malex, but you don't see any freeze. It is using big nums if it needs to on occasion. But it does not, unless it's invoking a macro, the compiler doesn't like avow scheme code. It doesn't try to package its own work into some racket representation of that work and invoke it. So that means if I need to make a closure at the level of the compiler's implementation, then I can do that by hand in C, of course, but it's not convenient.
Yeah, but I guess what I'm trying to say is that we don't see tons of different kinds of types because you're essentially using the scheme type for everything.
That's you're right. So you see the type scheme object very often. That's any, right? That's I'm using it even for the internal structures of the compiler. That is all true.
Which could be considered a good thing, right?
Yeah, there's a very C racket hybrid view taken in this code. I think the only other thing I wanted to mention is that in this complicated code that's sorting out whether it can break a let rec into a let, then it has to figure out whether the right-hand side might invoke a call CC. All right, that's the main complication that you wouldn't think of otherwise. So you might have something that says, let X be F applied to Y. If you don't know anything about Y, if you say let rec X be F applied to Y, if you don't know anything about F, it might capture a continuation. So you cannot turn that into a let. It has to stay a let rec because the let rec means the X is allocated before the function is called. You know, the space is made for it, whereas let would mean the space is made after it's called.
So how good is that, you know, might invoke call CC?
That's a good question. I don't know. Let's go look at it. So it approximates it by, it might invoke call CC if it's not liftable. What does liftable mean? Liftable is, could we take it out of a let rec at all? We're going to sort of walk down the IR to decide this. So if it's a lambda, for example, yeah, you can lift that out as long as you haven't already shifted into applying this function and so on. So you get a sense here, it's walking through a handful of the types. When it sees an application, sometimes it's asking questions about primitives. So the vast majority of primitives will not capture a continuation, and so they're marked as such. And so on. Does that kind of give you a sense?
Maybe. So my guess is that this default case, for instance, is that like the I give up case?
Well, the default case here is, yeah, the default case is I give up. Although usually when you hit here, it's because you've got a literal value in the code.
Mm-hmm. So this does answer my question in the sense of it's short, so that makes me suspect that maybe it's not super accurate. But in practice, how accurate really is it? Do you have any sense of that? Does this matter, for instance, making this more precise?
My guess is that this is not going to matter much, that it's precise enough already.
Mm-hmm. Just as an aside, you know, as we're going through, could you take a moment and when you see something where you know, hey, this could be improved in this way, because, you know, some of the audience, they might say, you know, after watching this, I really want to make some contribution, and, Matthew mentioned this is a place that might happen.
Yeah, the temptation for that will be much greater in the optimizer section, since
okay,
that's where the things we think matter happen, and that's where Gustavo will start to jump in a lot more, I expect, too, because he has mostly taken, as far as I can tell, this for granted, and and worked at the interesting part, the optimizer.
I see. And just one more thing about that whole conversation we had about whether it's the C code is schemey. Like, would it make sense to make it more schemey? Or is really that's not important? We should really just go right to the Racket version?
Yeah, the reason to go to the Racket version is to make it more portable, right? Mm-hmm. So that we can run it on different runtime systems. So I'm not sure what would be more schemey usefully at the current code, unless you have something concrete to suggest, but I don't think so.
Okay.
So.
Oh, hold on, one other thing. So Scott asked the question, you know, we've just walked through all this code inside of the letrec, which is trying to recover or trying to avoid the letrec. Does that tell us as programmers that we should try to avoid letrec and we should try to use let star whenever we can, etc.? Or does
That's
it not matter because they ultimately all turn into this thing in the first place?
I think this works well enough and that you should not have to avoid letrec. I mean, usually it's internal definitions. And we have done some things. I thought about talking about it in this code, but we've already spent more time on it. Somewhere in here, there's various decisions made about whether this is from an internal definition context or really let values. Because we've made different choices for internal definition context, we've made the rules so that if syntactically, all right, we'll be very concrete. I said before that if you have let rec x be f applied to y, that you cannot change that to let. But if you have an internal definition context that says define f to be f applied to y, we've syntactically changed the rules so that that can be changed to a let, right? Because f applied to y doesn't mention x. So that's why using internal definition context normally avoids the pitfalls here.
Looks like we had some sort of interruption. So currently, Matthew and Gustavo are not on. I'm going to wait for them to add themselves back on. Oh, here's Matthew again.
I guess I'm back.
Sorry about that. Something happened.
Are we good enough? I should continue?
Yeah.
I have a sense of where I dropped out, I think, because I got really quiet.
Yeah, the last thing that I heard was that maybe we should just rely on the macro writer's bill of rights and not worry too much about using letrec, etc. Because, you know, the main thing is this works well, and the main thing of concern is those internal definition contexts.
Yeah, and I was going. So what I added to myself was that we've changed the rules for internal definition contexts so that more often they can be turned into let. So let rec x f applied to y, that cannot be turned into let x. But define x f applied to y in an internal definition context, that can be, even without knowing anything about f, because of the way we set the rules up. So use internal definition context is the answer.
I see.
OK. We should move along unless there's specific questions.
Nope. So let's pop back.
OK. Let rec check. The main dispatch function here looks the way you expected it to look with all these cases for the different types. In the interest of time, I will just point out that if you're interested in the details, see the top of the file. It describes what's going on there. So that was because Claire wrote what she did, and then I revised it as I changed things. So, So let's move on to the optimizer.
Okay.
Scheme optimizer expert, again, it looks like you would expect. If you look at the C code enough, you'll see this kind of thing at the top of functions all the time to handle Stack Overflow, so you start to just not see it anymore. Here's what the optimizer is doing with variable references. This is where things start to get interesting, more so also for Gustavo, so he might jump in at this point. So you're in the optimizer, you're optimizing a local variable reference. The optimizer asks, is it mutated? That is there a set bang somewhere on this? If so, don't try too hard. So if you want the optimizer to do good things with your variables, don't mutate them. You can see it increments a virtual clock here to say some time has passed, which will prevent this reference from being reordered with other things. Right? It also registers the variable as used. So the optimizer, as it goes through, the compiler has originally computed a count for how many things are used. The optimizer is going to compute just one bit to say, yes, I'm still using it, or no, I'm not using it anymore. And the optimizer uses both of those things to decide to drop variables and bindings as it can.
Can you say just a tiny bit about the structure of the optimizer? Is it going to look at, is it going to do one pass? You know, right here we're looking at it for a variable reference. If we were to look at, I don't know, an application, is that the point where we're going to have a little while loop where it's going to look at each one multiple times?
Most of the time it's a straight pass, not a loop, but the main difference is let. The hard things like that are always in let. And so it's the let rec case in particular where it says, okay, I've done the right-hand sides and I've learned about the right-hand sides. Let's try again to maybe do some unrolling and inlining in that area.
Okay, so
module is acting like let in that sense. It'll similarly have a little loop there. But it's those loops are just two times instead of n times.
Sure, and so in contrast to, let's say, you know, the nanopass architecture or what we might read about in, you know, some like static analysis flow thing, there's not some giant loop outside that's, you know, computing some sort of analysis results to a fixed point. It really is, you know, syntax directed.
That's right. Yep.
Okay, and now two questions came in about, you know, that whole Stack Overflow thing that you wanted to skip over. People are just so curious about this because they haven't looked at the code. So first of all, you know, you've got this ifdef here, do stack check. Is this ever not true?
No, it's not. Not anymore. Maybe it was never true. So that would be a great thing to clean up. But it sort of delimits the code. You know, it's the fixed pattern that I learned to see, so I keep them around.
Okay. And then the other thing is that, you know, Just a little bit of explanation about the Stack Overflow, and maybe I'll try to say it, and you can just say yes. So, C does not guarantee tail call optimization. So, how does the virtual machine do that? The virtual machine does this by checking to see if the stack gets too big, at which point it trampolines back, and so it has some outer point where it escapes all the way back, and then it will call again, starting from the point that it got to, clearing up the tail frames in between.
Yeah, except it's not about tail calls at all. It's about just having an unbounded continuation size. So as you're recurring through an expression, the expression could be arbitrarily deep. And then it's not like you don't want to mash that into a loop. You just want to recur on sub-expressions.
I see. So we got to save the fact that okay, yeah.
Yeah. So you see these things in functions like schema-optimized expression that can explore arbitrarily deep.
Okay, very good.
Okay.
Yep.
So we've done very little with mutatable things. Then the next thing it will do will say, is this variable bound to something that we can just propagate along, like constant propagation or variable propagation? You know, if you say let x be y, then all the x's get replaced by y. Assuming y is not mutable, et cetera, et cetera. So if it is such a value is not the right term necessarily, it's still an expression probably, it could be a value as an expression, then we just drop that in and re-optimize. So this is one of the few places where we sort of recur to re-optimize. Collapse local is a special case that...
Ooh, hold on. So re-optimizing there is actually really interesting because you're re-optimizing with a different info and context.
It's the info and context that I started with coming into this expression.
What I'm trying to say is that when you did that info propagate local, that val came from some other place potentially in the source code, but now we may have learned a little bit since we knew that, you know, x was y.
Possibly.
Okay, sorry.
Yeah, that's a good point. So usually that the interesting ways that that happens is with inlining, though, which is not really handled right here. It's handled at the application part.
Okay.
Collapse local is something that Gustavo added, I believe, because it says if we're in a Boolean context and we know that the value of this variable is a predicate, for is a function, for example, or anything that's not false, we can just replace it with true. Or if we have checked whether this value is null, then we don't need to use the variable. We can just replace it with null. That was collapse local. If we're not in a context where someone has promised us to check for us whether it's single valued or not, that's just making sure that it's okay to do this thing. Then
single valued being what we expect. Like, we normally think of our programs' values as being the exception.
Yeah, yeah. So if we're not in a context that's already trying to enforce that for us, somehow, I'm not honestly, I'd have to look at the code a little more to remember why that check is there.
Okay.
But otherwise, this is another kind of constant propagation. So we're looking at the known value field, right? So these other things looked at some things. Some of it is supplied by the context, like info might have accumulated predicates that have been evaluated. But this one was just set at the binding site. Sometimes you have let x be a big expression, where that expression can't be collapsed to a constant or something, but it might be moved to the use site. So you said let x be floating point add of y and z, and then later you use x in exactly one place, then it might be good to move that expression down to where x is actually used. Right? So that's once used is a wrapper around expressions that can be moved that way. So
Matthias makes the comment that at this point, you know, someone else should review this talk and go through and add little source level racket source examples to each one of these cases so that future generations will understand, okay, if it looks like this code at the source level, it's going to turn into this.
Yeah, that's a good idea. That shows up in some of the code, but as we'll see, but not that would be a great thing right here. Yeah, there are all sorts of constraints on whether you can actually move something. Mm-hmm. So, you know, maybe there's been a side effect in between A clock. Gustavo, do you remember what A is?
Is it the allocation clock?
Oh, yeah. Something's been allocated in between. Spans K means the continuation might have been captured in between.
And hold on. Does A clock also mean, since allocation could have happened, garbage collection could have happened, thus pointers could be different?
No, we don't worry about garbage collection. Okay. The allocation issue is only about space safety and not moving things to where the garbage collector. So that's an indirect GC thing, moving things across where a GC may have cleaned them up.
Hey, can I make a comment?
Yes.
I think that allocation clock is about continuations. If you store something and then you have a continuation, then you have to get the same value. If you move the allocation at the continuations, you get a different value each time.
Right, that's it. I wonder if, let's see if the comments would have helped us with that. So we can go look at optimize info for constraining reorders. Yeah, there we go. Okay, so I should have checked the code. Of course, the reason this comment is here is because Gustavo asked for it. So that's exactly the kind of thing this is for. So it might be that all of these clocks are good enough, or it might be that the expression can always be moved. So movable expression is another one of these things. It looks at the expression for a little while. You'll see a lot of these take a fuel. I believe 5 is the fuel here. That says how much we're allowed to look, and this just prevents quadratic or exponential behavior by giving up after a little while. So things that can be moved are local variables that are not mutated, applications of such things using primitives that can be moved, and so on. Right, if everything else fails, then we just say we're going to keep the variable as it is and remember that we're actually using it. And keep track of some things about clocks.
So about that fuel, it's like, you know, did you spend a lot of time figuring out that 5 was a good number?
No, we use 5 a lot. 10 every once in a while.
Okay, very good.
That could be a place for tuning, I don't know. My sense is that 5 is enough for the cases you expect to work.
Okay.
But yeah, there may be some room there. I think I want to talk about what do I want to talk about next? Yeah. So let's look at. Let me do this in a different order. Let's look at applications first.
Okay.
So applications I'm looking at first because that's where inlining actually happens. There are a lot of other ad hoc optimizations in applications too. So the first thing that's going to happen here in the application, it's actually looking for in the rater position whether it's a let, in which case it's going to rearrange it, pushing the application under the let instead of having the let in the rater. So for example, this would look for something like let open let f be a function, return f, a, b, c, so it can get changed to the same let f, a, b, c, that sort of thing.
I see.
So if it succeeds in that transformation, it's also responsible for optimizing afterwards, and so we just return it. So all of these things are things to try. If it succeeds, then you're done. Otherwise, continue on. Ad hoc optimization, if you have a call CC and the argument that you pass to the function is never used, then you didn't really need to capture the continuation. I think Gustavo added that one. Optimize for inline. So this is, this is where we're looking for similar sorts of patterns that can be reordered. So,
Matthew, as you find the next thing to talk about, let me just make a little comment. Someone asks, those fuel parameters that we've seen, a lot of other compilers will expose those to the user to say, spend more time on this, spend more time on that. And, Spencer would like maybe Leaf in the future version of the compiler to do that. And maybe just a little question, is it imaginable that there could be syntax property information that said these sorts of things? Is that information available at this level of the optimizer, or has it really, there's a gulf between what the user put in and that?
The front end would have to propagate any syntax property-based annotations.
It wouldn't be free, is what you're saying.
Yeah, I mean, they just need to be stuck into the IR structure somewhere.
Okay.
Yeah, so actually this is the main try to inline function. So it says, do I have a lambda? Good, I'm going to be able to inline. Do I have a local variable that is bound to a lambda? Then LE will turn out to be something that maybe it can use. Or maybe it's bound, maybe the local variable refers to a top level, and the top level corresponds to an inline variance thing. So all of this is basically different cases trying to turn LE into a lambda that we can inline. Right. So if we eventually get there, we got an LE, it is a lambda, and we still have some inlining fuel available. Right. We should come back to that in a minute. Mm-hmm. Then do some more checks to see if we really can inline. Like if there's rest arguments, that's probably going to disable inlining. If it's too big, that's going to disable inlining. But if you get down here, that means it's small enough, it has a reasonable shape, the number of arguments match the number of expected arguments, and so on. So we make a copy of the lambda. To clone it. What's that? That's going to make new instances of all the variables that are inside the lambda, so that the identity of the variable object. I am still on, right? Okay.
Yeah, you're still on.
Got quiet, but I guess I'm just talking too much. And so we make a copy of it, and then that's what we actually inline. So apply any inline does the inlining.
And so hold on. So this code, I mean, is this the stuff that's specialized for the one application case, the two, the three?
Or no.
Is this generalized at this point?
This one is generalized. Yeah, okay. When we go back to optimize application 2, we'll see a bunch of ad hoc things that are specific to two arguments.
Okay. And maybe just to remind us, the reason why it's specialized, I mean, why isn't there just a test somewhere that says if n is greater than 2, if n is greater than 3?
Yeah, exactly. That's what it should be in the intermediate form.
Oh, but I thought you said before that it's good that it works this way because it optimizes for space in the runtime representation.
Yes, at runtime it's good. So having it at the bytecode level is good, but this intermediate level, it's too early to have that split.
I see.
So it's maybe just a historical artifact.
Okay. And the reason why, just to say, is that if you know that there's two, then you just store them right there. You don't have a pointer off to some list.
That's right. Yeah. Okay. It's just the application forms are so common that it actually matters in the footprint to reduce some indirections and even a word here and there.
Okay.
So if we do actually inline, that's where we were, apply inline, then it does what you expect. It makes a let. It sets up the right-hand sides, moves the body into the body of the let, and then optimizes the let.
Mm-hmm. So at this point, can you talk about like what the inlining algorithm is? So,
yes.
And maybe just kind of another question is that, like, you know, when we were looking a little bit before about the variable code and the lambda code, we saw some stuff that mentioned inlining, and you know, you said that there's the size and the p size.
Mm-hmm.
Like, is the logic of the inlining algorithm really spread throughout the entire thing?
A bit, yeah. So setting those sizes and setting up the association from variables to lambdas is going to happen in the let and the module forms.
Mm-hmm.
Those are the two things that can see the bindings and set those up.
Okay. So I guess kind of what I mean is that would it be possible to have different inlining algorithms, or really is the logic of the inlining algorithm so spread throughout that doesn't make sense?
Well, no, I think you could, because that connection between variables and lambdas is going to be the same everywhere. And then the different inlining algorithms are about your heuristics. Should I inlining? You know, knowing that you can inlining, that's going to be common to all the algorithms.
I see.
And the difference is really, should you inline or not?
Mm-hmm.
So the algorithm that we use is, I believe, by Manuel Serrano, where we have a certain amount of fuel that you start out with. As you recur down an expression, then when you perform an inlining, you deduct from that fuel. So that fuel basically accounts for both the size that you're willing to inline and how many times you're willing to inline. Because the amount of fuel you deduct is based on the size of what you inline. But it only goes down. So if you have two expressions in a begin, the inlining of the first one will not count against the second one. Right? The fuel's... the fuel is sort of used up as you go down towards the leaves.
I see.
Independently.
And what is the inlining like trying to accomplish, you might say? Like, is it optimized, like the heuristics, have they been chosen for, you know, like just general compile time, space, fast?
Well, the thing is, it's faster to not call a function than call a function. So yep. Ideally, you would just always inline when you can. But if you do that, the competing trade-off is that you blow up the code.
Mm-hmm.
Or you have an infinite loop. You have a loop that you can't unwind forever. So the inliner is trying to make that trade-off. You know, it wants to always inline, but it doesn't want to blow up the code too much.
I see.
The fuel is constraining how much you blow up.
Okay, and the heuristics have been chosen, like, by, let's say, Manuel, by your doing experimentations?
Mostly by Manuel. And so the really just this idea of propagating the fuel down the tree, deducting as you go towards the leaves, that is the main thing. The second question that we, if we eventually get there, about let recs and modules is, do you inline within a function body before you inline that function? Or do you inline the function and then only inline in the result of that? That's really the hard trade-off. And so that's where there's maybe some extra heuristics. I forget how much of that I was able to get just out of Manuel's paper here.
Sure. And then another sort of side comment there. I mean, sometimes if you inline now, you'll reveal information that will allow you to optimize even more and thus get something smaller.
Yeah, exactly.
So I imagine that the fuel doesn't like can't really take that into account.
I believe it does. It's when you actually inline, then we compute the size of what you inlined.
So I guess what I'm trying to say is that, like, let's suppose that you have 5 units left, but this thing it says if you inline this, it would be 6 units.
Right.
If you inline, then it would ultimately become 1 unit.
That's right. It can't take that into account. That's right.
And so we could imagine a much more expensive compiler that did that and then would look at how it optimized and then say, no, that's too much. But I don't know if other compilers, if that's a thing that they do. But okay.
Right. I don't know either.
Okay.
And people have heard me say this before, but messing with inlining heuristics is extremely unrewarding. because the space there is so many local minimums and maximums, and you rarely make progress uniformly. And,
okay.
Yeah, so this has worked pretty well. let's see. So that's how inlining is a lot of what happens, and then in finish optimize. Application 2, that means rater and rands, there's one argument, and so we have lots of ad hoc things like car or could or of kinds of xy should just be x or y, and so on for various things there, like cons and car and list combinations, list star. Let's see, there's some special handling of varref. Zero question mark of something that we know is a fixed num can maybe be changed to a cheaper operation. Uses unsafe fx eek. And then a lot more of those. So here we have a rater. If that rater turns out to be the car primitive, and if this ran satisfies the pair predicate, then change car to unsafe car. And also, while you're at it, even if you can't change it to unsafe car, you have done a car, so hereafter, rand, we know it matches that predicate. So if rand is a variable, then later uses of the variable in the same branch, we'll know that they're a pair, and so we might be able to change other things. So that's what checkNone is doing.
The checkNone does that on all these different things.
Yeah, it's both exploiting and registering these predicate.
So, I mentioned before about things that people could do. Could some contributor look in here and just sort of make this list much, much more big?
It could be. That is a place where things could be done. So you can see a lot of these are enumerated explicitly. Some of them we have flags attached to primitives so that we can cover a lot of them at once. So a lot of numeric functions want a real and produce a real, or want a number and produce a number. These cover several of those cases all in one place. But we don't try to do anything with strings, for example, or characters. I don't know what would be profitable.
Okay.
We were pretty sure that numbers and lists were profitable.
Okay.
Right, and this again is where Gustavo has bulked up a lot of the capability and added a lot more primitives and transformations.
So hold on one sec as well. So Sam says, these, like the word car there. So I mean, how dangerous should we think this is? Like, if car were named something else, would it matter? If car were implemented in Racket, so would it matter? Because we can imagine.
CheckNone uses checkNone variant, which says, is the thing actually a primitive? And okay, so we just know it's the only primitive registered in Racket with the name car.
Okay. And so what that means is that, there might be, in the same way that we're trying to move this code out of C, there's all sorts of other things inside of the C code that we could potentially move out. I mean, for instance, we just looked at car. I mean, that's a C-A-A-R. So C-A-A-R could be implemented in Racket and then inlined, and then this optimization would no longer be useful.
Right.
So I guess what I'm trying to say is that if we were to just replace the definition of C, of let's say Catter, if we were to just move Catter into Racket, is the rest of the inlining infrastructure going to recover the value of this? Or is this line right here, does it justify including it in C?
I think, so let's suppose you define Catter to be car of coder of x, define Catter literally like that. Well, the first problem with that implementation is you get a different error message if x has the wrong thing. So the Catter primitive currently checks all of the things about x and then complains about x if it doesn't have the full shape.
Yep.
So if you wanted to replicate that, then your definition starts looking like if x is a pair and the car is a pair and so on.
Uh-huh. And then you're throwing an error, and throwing an error is capturing.
Then you're throwing an error, and so on. So it's a good question. I think the optimizer is getting closer to being able to deal with that well, but I don't know how well it deals with it. I don't know how much you would want to go the route of making Catter a macro to sort of force the inliner, forcing inlining in that sense.
Mm-hmm.
So the R5RS Catter, which of course uses mutable pairs instead of, instead of immutable pairs, we've defined that as a macro, if I recall correctly. So there's some combination of things. I think that's very tractable to make improvements along that line and still maintain the optimizer's results.
Okay.
Through a combination of macros and inlining hints, maybe, if it doesn't just work.
I think. Oh, hello.
Yes.
I think that the problem is not here, because if the special version of car is inlined, then the type will be recorded anyway. But the problem is before, because if you calculate car of a pair, then it is optimized. But the special, when you split that, when you split the definition, the error check and the actual car will have two copies of the variable, so it will not propagate it.
Oh, interesting.
Yep, that is a good concern. Yep.
Yes, I think the problem is in this part of the code.
Yep. Yeah, dealing with the multiple uses of the variable could have a significant effect. Yep.
Okay, interesting.
Okay, so let's try to move towards the last bit. Optimize lets. Well, optimize lets is big and complicated, getting better, but there's a lot of room for improvement. So it's doing all sorts of things. It's handling special cases like this. So if all of this is guarded by we are in a test position already, so this is in the test position of an if, then we don't really care about the value of m here. We know it's going to be used as true in the end. So there's I think this turns out to be useful for and or expansion or something like that.
Okay.
This is useful for giving names to fun. This one is useful for all sorts of things that expand to nested lets. You're sort of linearizing the lets in a different dimension than the other one, makes other things possible in the optimizer. This code will again figure out that when it has a let, it can be reduced to just a let. Sorry, when it has a let rec, that it can be reduced to a let. Here's another thing we see. So if we have enabled this in the optimizer, and I believe this one is on. Yes, this one is on. So this says, lost it. Let's try again. So this is where we estimate function size before we optimize the right-hand sides of a let rec.
Mm-hmm.
To encourage or discourage inlining. And then we are in the while loop. We're in the loop where we deal with all the clauses. You will see there is all sorts of handling of different cases. Do we have let values with values on the right-hand side? Let's split them up. That affects minor. We've already optimized the right-hand side, so we don't want to re-optimize it, so there are different mode flags that happen as a result. Do we have something that's not mutated, it's just a single variable in the clause? Can we pull out a simple value from the right-hand side, like a simple expression, maybe a constant, maybe a function? Can we pull out some information about a function, if not the actual function itself? If it would be okay to just copy that down to its uses, then we record it here in the known val. We saw where that was used before. Some other cases, like we're not in a let rec and it's not capturing a continuation, or it's just a variable propagation, or it's something that it turns out we recorded that the use count was just one, then we record a once used record. Right? So we do all of that. That's connecting information about right-hand sides to variables. And then also we say, well, we're in a let rec, and we've already optimized the right-hand side once. Should we go through and do it again? That's what this little loop is doing.
Mm-hmm.
So there's a loop in here that makes clones of all the right-hand sides, tries to re-optimize them, sees whether that optimization seemed to be a good idea. This is not only for inlining, it's also for computing a fixed point of certain things, like does that function always return a single value, which is a handy thing for the optimizer to know or for the JIT to know.
Okay.
And that may, if you have a recursive function, it's very common for a recursive function to eventually reproduce a single value, but that's a little fixed point computation. So this is doing all of that kind of stuff.
Okay.
And eventually puts it back together and says, This is where it's dropping variables that are not used, and often you can only drop variables, you can only drop the right-hand side if the right-hand side was side effect free. So I'm surprised you haven't looked at this function yet, but scheme omittable expression is a kind of workhorse. Can I reorder? Can I drop this kind of drop this expression?
So is this essentially does have effect is kind of what it's asking?
It does have an effect. And an effect might be an error, right? If you have char of x, you can't drop it unless you know x. Mm-hmm. Or actually, I should say, what's another example? Plus x1, right? There's no side effect unless x is not a number, and so on. This omittable expression is used in the optimizer. It's also used in the resolver. It's also used by the bytecode verifier. So it's used in a lot of places where we need to recheck, does something have no side effect? And because it's used in various places, it has some various modes, like are we working on resolved code or not? Is it OK to get rid of mutable variables because it's just a reference that will be not raise an error for some reason, and so on?
Does that mean that there's some giant table somewhere, this primitive has an effect, but this primitive doesn't, this primitive errors?
Yeah, it's not a table, but wherever we make where we allocate one of those things, or where we create the plus primitive that has a bunch of flags on it that says I have these kinds of properties, that I don't raise an exception, I don't try to capture the continuation, I don't jump to arbitrary code, those kinds of things are all various flags and attributes of primitives.
Would you say that those are accurate right now? I'm thinking of something that someone might want to do.
You mean make them more precise? I think you're unlikely to find imprecisions that could be improved, but it might be. There might be. Most of them are pretty straightforward. Yeah.
I'm just imagining that presumably this wasn't always there. So at some point, you had to go through and write down what the flags of various primitives were.
Yeah. So there are a lot of less used primitives, though these flags are probably imprecise. Mm-hmm. Like the random function is probably imprecise and probably intentionally imprecise because we use random as a do not optimize me for testing purposes sometimes. But other things sort of in the same similar category to random might have more precise flags than they do.
I see.
But they're less often used, so they're not likely to speed anything up. That's why we haven't focused on them, I'd say. Yet another recurse, traversal through IRs with various. Is this a primitive that is functional and never fails?
So as a related question, so this is detecting effects. Is this code going to detect local mutation that's not exposed?
It will not. When it sees things that are mutated, it assumes it's global mutation, globally visible.
Okay. Leaf asked the question about random. Why not make an actual primitive that is just called do not optimize me?
That's a good idea. Yep.
Okay.
Laziness.
Random. Yeah, I don't think that anyone would call you lazy, Matthew. So.
Okay. So there's so many things. We've already gone on for too long, and there's so many things we could talk about, like tracking. We need how the compiler notices that you're calling make struct type and that it's the usual pattern so that it can recognize the predicate and the selectors and so on, all of which have important properties, like the predicate never fails. It takes one argument and never fails. So a predicate application whose result is not used can be discarded and so on. So that's a place where this is showing up. And you can see that there's this notion of procedure shapes that's really about structure procedures, being a constructor, a predicate, and so on. Here's a fun one. It's make vector, and you know that it's a small integer, so it's always going to succeed.
So, this might be a good moment to sort of, speculate a little bit. I'm not trying to be too critical, but this is the sort of thing, this make vector proc. If this were in a research paper describing a compiler, there'd just be a giant table somewhere of rewrite rules that would say, if it's this thing and that goes on. I mean, in your opinion, is that just not plausible to make a compiler that way for Racket?
No,
or?
I think that would work much better. I think that I wouldn't have known what goes into that table until we have a bunch of this code.
Uh-huh.
And so what happened is we just have a bunch of this code and we continue to have a bunch of this code instead of at some point stepping back and saying, how can we abstract over it? Where we have the backed and said how we can we abstract over it was more in this in these kinds of things. Right? Now, this is relatively table like, right?
Yeah, definitely.
Where actually we figured out the right shape of check known and so on. But okay. Yeah, these are places where if this code is going to live a long time, we would want to do that kind of thing.
Okay, so another perspective is that, you know, the Racket version of the compiler, it's not a port of this compiler. It's really a new Racket compiler that says, what do we know about how to compile Racket? Let's make something from scratch.
Like yeah. That. Yeah, and hopefully this code serves as that example of the kinds of things you want to do that suggest the abstractions. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And also, I get another sense of there's really just one, there's logically one pass. You know, as we saw, you know, the let may run multiple times. Like, do you think it has been valuable to have that single pass perspective as opposed to, you know, we're going to analyze everything and look for variable sizes. We're going to analyze everything and do the inlining step, etc.
A lot of this comes out of the history where we have something that works and we want to make it go faster without slowing anything down. And so my view of the bytecode compiler is that it's almost free. I think that the bytecode compiler doesn't take measurable time. Similar to JET, I mean, it's you can measure it if you make things big enough. In contrast to macro expansion, where that's the time you're actually seeing when you load code from source. So we just sort of stayed in that mode because things worked at a certain speed before and we wanted to only speed things up. That has kept the compiler and the optimizer in these relatively tight constraints.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not at all clear that that's the right thing. But that's why it looks... That's more an explanation than an opinion on what it should be. I'm not really sure what it should be.
Sure. Okay.
I would like to get to just one last thing. That's okay.
Yep.
And that is this closure conversion part. So we're now on the resolve pass, so the optimizer has done all its work. It's inlined as much as is going to be inlined. It's tried to simplify the lets and let recs as much as it can. The resolve pass is going to look at it one more time and say, okay, you claim we have a let rec. Let's see. First it's going to look at everything and say, okay, these are the bindings I'm dealing with. Here it says you claim you have a let rec. Do we really need to keep it as a let rec as the general kind that's going to have set bings? Right, so rec box will be true if we really need to do the set bing form. Otherwise, if it's false, maybe we've collected the number of... actually, either way, true or false, we've collected the number of lambdas that could be packaged into a nice kind of let rec. Or if it's not a let rec, can we just do simple let ones all the way through? If so, do that. So if we don't have simple let ones, maybe we need to do a kind of general let rec thing. First, keep track of things that we know we can just omit because the optimizer, in principle, the optimizer would have removed these, but for whatever reason, it didn't figure things out fast enough. So okay. We have one more pass to figure out that we can remove them. And then compute possible lifts here is the key part. So it's saying, I've got let recs, I've got some functions, these lambdas, they're closures, they're closing over things. But they only refer to each other. The variables are only used in application positions. So I can lift these lambdas to the top and turn things into the closures to arguments. So that's what compute possible lifts does. And it produces the info about what lifts are possible. And then we go through and make the let recs. If we can lift it, we drop it out. If we can't lift it, we keep it in the let rec. So let's look at compute possible lifts. Compute possible lifts is going to go through the whole thing up to three times, depending. Right? So the first time it says, let's be optimistic. Let's say that all of these lambdas on the right-hand side can be empty closures. They don't even need to refer to module-level things because they only use primitives, say. And so it tries that, and you know, this might be true among a set of functions, odd and even, so that's why it's doing it all together.
Yep.
If that fails and it says, okay, well, some of them refer to top-level variables, let's try again, just assuming that they all need the top-level in their closure, right? And if that's true, then good, and if not, that says, then it falls back to creating closures. So that's why it goes, that's the three times. You know, empty closures, closures that only refer to module and top-level things, or general closures.
And there could be other options, right?
Yeah, I expect so, yeah. Yeah, so it might be that half of them could be closed and the other half need to refer to top-level variables and so on. So that's I don't know how much room for improvement there is. Or maybe, what do you have in mind by other options?
Well, I just mean that, the key here is that they really can't refer to anything local. It's just nothing or... So what I'm trying to say is that this isn't where you figure out the two closures that you're about to create could share the same rib, right? Because it's flat, so they're never going to share anyways.
That's right. We don't even try, right?
Okay.
Yeah, it's just avoiding closure, either avoiding closure creation entirely or moving it to the top of the module. That's what it's trying to do.
I see. Okay.
It involves this iteration where it keeps calling resolve lambda, telling it that it's in lift mode. So these various flags are different lift modes. Right. So can I lift? Am I resolving lambda in a place where I'm allowed to lift it up? Am I in the phase where I am trying to actually lift it? Or am I just being asked to figure out whether I could be lifted and what the implications would be?
And right. While this is happening, we're also changing all those variables into the static distances, right?
We are. So we're doing that, right? It's kind of, if it's just computing the lift information, it may compute those distances but throw them away. But mm-hmm. Eventually, yes, we're computing that. And so you see that in this code. Well, again, a lot of things are happening. So another thing the optimizer and the resolver do is figure out unboxing to help the JIT. Mm-hmm. So it's really at the resolve phase that we've got enough information that we can make that calculation. This is where we are collecting all the variables that are in the closure and sort of deciding what order we're going to put them in the closure so that we have the coordinate for the body. But also, if we refer to something that it turns out is going to be lifted, and we drop it from the closure and refer to that thing either at the top level, if it needed to close over the top level, or just referring to a closure directly. And as we do that,
your audio is getting a little bit scratchy, at least for me, maybe for other people too. Could you just hold off one sec? Now try again. Could you say something?
Okay, about now.
Oh, nope, it's still doing it for me. Let me just get confirmation from somebody else that it's happening to them as well.
Okay.
Asking on Slack. Remember what you did before to get it to go away? Yes.
I think we ultimately got disconnected.
Okay, it just got fixed.
Okay, great.
Okay, good.
I see mostly people saying it's fuzzy, but maybe that's old news now.
Okay. I can hear fine now, so... Okay, yep, it's fixed.
Okay. So the point is that it's equally important to figure out that unboxing information as we go. When we refer now to something that's been lifted, the condition of lifting might be that we can supply the free variables that it used to have as arguments to the call, mm-hmm. which might mean that we pull in more things into our closure with the expectation, of course, that they'll be converted away as well for all call sites. So that's what this little extra loop is doing. Now that we've got some things lifted, we might increase our set of captured variables. Let's sort them to make sure it's all deterministic. And then figure out if we can do lifting, if we can shift things from the closure into the parameters.
So you just mentioned sorting them to make sure it's deterministic. I mean, is there any value to different orderings inside of the closure?
Unlikely. No. There might be some value to the order being consistent, because at the JIT level, when you have a tail call to a function, and you're trying to move what was your first argument into the first argument of the new function, then it just doesn't have to move.
I see.
Is it the first or the last? I forget. But anyway, some end of it. And the lifting here is done with that ending in mind. So it's probably important that it's consistent, but otherwise not important which order you pick.
Okay.
And so on. So this makes this is where we make the closure map, where we map the variables into new positions for the body based on where they're unpacked from the closure. All right. Yeah, somehow it just keeps going, right? So in this case, this is where we were just being called to convert it and produce information about the conversion to say what variables need to be lifted at the application site. So we would see in the resolver, the application form looks for lifting and it adds extra variables as it needs to call lifted functions. Right. SFS is really straightforward, so I won't even go look at it, but it just sort of walks down, does aliveness analysis on the variables, finds the last point in which a given variable is used, checks whether any potentially allocating functions after that use before the function exits, and if so, zeros out the variable.
And it is precise.
Yeah, it's really, let's see, are there any imprecisions there? I think it's completely precise.
And it's and it zeros out so that the so the garbage collector will then not have a reference anymore. So it doesn't save the space on like in the stack cell. It just makes sure that there's no longer a reference so that the object could be free.
That's right. So it's precise but potentially pessimistic in that it might zero something out if it doesn't know enough about a primitive when it didn't actually need to be zeroed out. But the cost of zeroing is, of course, fairly small.
Is there any justification for us as Racket programmers to, you know, set bang things to null? Or is that a really bad idea? Because now they're mutable.
Well, it's pretty rare that you would need to set things to null. I mean, module-level variables, top-level variables, yes, you might need to do that to clear them out. Local variables in a function seems rare. Yeah, I guess you could have a loop where you sometimes use the variable and then you're done with it after some number of iterations. But you should probably write it a different way.
Okay, good.
Okay, and then resolve, it goes backwards. It works for the patterns of LETs that are generated by the bytecode compiler. So that would be an interesting thing if there are multiple compilers, right? Because the intermediate format...
So just to clarify, it's not really maybe fully abstract would be the right way to say it.
It's not fully abstract.
Yeah. The intermediate representation can do more. Yeah. Sorry, the bytecode can do more than the intermediate representation can do. So you can't just generate a bytecode and then turn it back because certain patterns don't make sense. Can you give like one example of that?
Well, so nothing says that let void has to have the let values immediately after. So you could have let void and then a bunch of math and then later start binding variables. And the unresolver will be unhappy with that. For cross-module inlining, it'll simply give up. In other cases where you really insisted that it be unresolved, it'll complain that it doesn't recognize the pattern.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, that seems like enough modular questions. So are there any questions left?
Sure. I think that one of the big questions is, you know, we've got to the... Maybe we can pop back to the compiler overview slide that you had.
Okay.
So back here at the end, we have zo, eval, and jit. Can you talk a little bit about whether it is sensible to add, you know, x86 at the end of there or LLVM at the end of there? Is that really something that has to be about the bytecode? I think maybe the question is that a lot of people aren't sure. They don't really have a sense of what the bytecode really looks like. So from my perspective, when I look at the docs for zoparse, let's say, I mean, it's not a machine in the way that we...
It's not like an x86 machine. Yeah, it's closer to a Racket machine.
Yeah,
it's closer to having lambdas and so on.
And so in that sense, it would be another big step to produce x86, right?
Yeah, so the JIT, I think of the JIT as a small step to x86, but it is relying on a lot of runtime support, right? It's relying on that there is this stack that's managed appropriately. It's relying on calling out to the GC to allocate things. So an x86 with a stack discipline, I would say it, and the JIT is also relying on to the ability to, say, make a closure, right?
Mm-hmm.
Which is another kind of allocation.
So in addition to having a big runtime library, it's also quite a high-level bytecode.
Yeah. I don't know. It's sort of intermediate.
Okay. So another person's question related to this is, you know, when they look at the bytecodes for things like Lua and JavaScript, they're very clearly focused on what kind of bytecode is going to give us the fastest runtime, and we're going to make all sorts of choices based on that. Would you say that the bytecode is organized around similar principles, or has a lot more history in it?
Similar principles and history seem like the same thing. It is about the bytecode evaluator. A lot of those choices, like having application and application 2 and application 3, was both about the size. There are some extra flags that I didn't comment on that are really hints to the interpreter. At the same time, I think it's a much smaller bytecode set than in some other VMs. In part because it's a tree instead of a linear representation of bytecode. In part, I don't know why. Maybe because it's more of a threaded interpreter where it was more designed to call out for addition even, rather than having an addition bytecode.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And then the next question someone asks, let me just read it. Questions before we go, can you talk about the type field in the bytecode, such as in the let one struct, where the values are num, flow num, value reference? Can you show us where those are, talk about what they mean, and, you know, just a little bit about how they get computed? I mean, we saw that a little bit as we were going through the passes, but this might be a good time to summarize it.
Yeah, so let's let me find where that is. So let's look at IR. Okay. So an IR local has val type and arg type, which are one of these piles of bits, which are either flow num, fix num, or xflow num. These are unboxing types. So these bits are set in the optimized pass in let. So when the optimizer for let notices that the right-hand side has this pattern, or the right-hand side, it's either like a literal number or it's a primitive that it knows generates this kind of number. And then the resolver copies these bits into a let one, or as we saw a little bit in the lambda, copy those bits into the type set for lambda. Am I answering the question there?
Yeah, I think so. And, you know, is it sensible to add a lot more types than that? Like, you know, are we understanding it right that it's really about numbers, or could we, like, would it make sense to have a whole category where we know this is a cons, let's say?
So probably not. The cons is, you're not going to get any good unboxing from cons, I think. Yeah, not usually. So I think it does really make sense for these limited set of things where unboxing is going to pay off. In this variable, we have, well, it doesn't show up here. It shows up in, beyond just the number types, we have the predicates, right? So there's sort of two layers of type information, the very specific one that's for unboxing, which is fix nums and flow nums, and then there's the more general predicates, which can get set in a flow-sensitive way, right? So it's not really a permanent property of the variable, it's only a property in this branch or so on. And we accumulate that information in a table here somewhere. This types. So those can be arbitrary predicates, and that set could be expanded quite a bit more from what we have. Right now, let's see, what is... What could I have to predicate? Radar implies predicate basically shows you all the kinds of predicates that we currently have have written specializations for.
Okay.
So real, number, pair, mutable pair, null, vector, boxes, void, procedure, that's it. Okay. So you can imagine quite a bit of expansion here. And then you have to, there's some functions that go along with that, like implies or implies not, that would need to be filled in.
And how do generative structs enter into these predicate tables?
Yeah, they don't currently. So there's this notion, we can recognize that something is a predicate of a struct, but it's currently not moved into the table or associated with the selectors that would go with it. But that would be a potential direction. Yeah.
So I would guess that would be a big win. Do you have any guess on that?
Yeah, it does sound profitable.
Okay. I think the last thing that we want to talk about maybe go back to the outline again, the diagram.
Let me actually. I thought of a follow-up comment to my previous answer.
Sure.
So you could imagine recognizing x question mark was applied to something, and then there's a field access x hyphen y.
Yep.
That you would specialize to an unsaved struct ref or something.
Exactly.
And we didn't do that for a long time because the bytecode was supposed to say safe, and verifiably safe. But
okay.
We gradually moved away from that. So it didn't used to be that the bytecode compiler would change car to unsafe car. Because the validator wouldn't have been able to prove that was still okay.
Okay.
So we've kind of weakened our expectations of what the validator can prove, and that if you start from source and the validator sort of double checks, it's useful as a check on the compiler. But we can't really trust bytecode to a useful extent anymore. Basically, you can seal things off. You can say, don't load bytecode because it sees an unsafe reference and it rejects it. But that's part of the history here that kind of explains why something like that, which seems profitable, is currently missing.
I see. Okay, that makes sense.
Now we can carry on with your...
Yeah, so can you go to the diagram? So we talked about how the long run is that a lot of this is going to be in a new compiler. If it isn't in the new compiler, like suppose that the compiler takes 2 years to do, like what is on your roadmap of these things that where are the holes of improvement?
That's a good question for Gustavo, maybe, because he's the one who's actually working on this stuff most of the time. The one thing I see has more to do with using the unresolver more at runtime. The unresolver and optimizer, sort of pulling them back into runtime as triggered by procedure specialize. Don't know whether that's going to pan out or not.
Okay.
But anyone else's guess is good or better than mine at this point. Probably the most profitable things are the things that I've overlooked that Gustavo hasn't looked at yet.
I see. And so it's not like you have a to-do list of, I would do X, Y, and Z if I had time, but I don't.
That's right.
Okay. And so the next question in that category is, as sort of advice to Leaf making the new compiler, there's the second system syndrome is going to make it so that a lot of the knowledge that you had making this compiler is going to get dropped in that first version. So, what would you say are the top two, top three most unexpected things you have learned about compiling record code?
Unexpected. I started out knowing nothing about compilers, so it was all unexpected.
Maybe another way to look at it is that, I can go read a whole lot of Kent and Manuel's papers about compiling scheme. And how, BigLoo does something very smart and ShaderScheme does something very smart. But we know that Racket is a very different language than ShaderScheme and BigLoo. Like, what am I going to really miss when I go read those compiler papers when I think about compiling Racket?
No, I'm not sure. I think that our programs rely on the particular specializations of primitives that we have. The performance that you can expect from them, the particular unboxing patterns that we've made. So in some sense, someone starting out from those papers trying to replace the Racket compiler really just needs needs to know what the primitives specific to Racket are and that the kind of things that we rely on there. So
okay.
The way that structs are... the various things that structs can do and how much the JIT handles them, for example.
Mm-hmm. So you just mentioned, these particular patterns that we rely on. When you try a new optimization, and maybe this is a question for Gustavo as well, are you running all of the publicly available Racket code and looking at, let's say, doctor-doctor, when you do a change, is it likely that Dr. Doctor is ever going to run, 5% faster, or is that the sort of thing that you would even think about?
I look at it constantly. I look at especially the builds, the timing build plots that happens every day. What it is called, buildplot.racketlang.org. Mm-hmm. Very hard to move that number, especially in the compiler. Moving that number, the easiest way to move that number is to improve the GC, but I may have exhausted that well for myself, at least as much as I can see for the near future. So, yeah, what we do is we rely on the optimizer benchmarks, optimizer test suite, to make sure we haven't lost a specific optimization. Mm-hmm. We do watch those numbers, but they rarely go up or down.
Can you just open that file just so that everyone knows where it is? I mean, we can, of course, find it by looking at it. I meant the optimized test suite. So generally, it always it's optimize.rktl. Generally, it always shows up every time you you make a change in the commit log, but it may be useful for the purposes of
right.
archival video to just say, look, here it is.
Yeah, here it is. So you see a lot of things like make sure this compiles the same as this. You know, if XX false should be the same as X.
And does it really, I mean, how does it really work? Like, is it looking at the bytecode that pops out that you compile?
It's generating the bytecode, marshaling the bytecode to a string, and comparing the byte string. So it's really making sure you get the same ZO out.
That's interesting.
Yep. Which makes it hard to test certain things, because every once in a while, because of the order of passes and so on, that the optimizer can't actually completely normalize two things, but the difference you don't really care about. So sometimes the I know a particular where a good example of this is here. So this example has list PP in it, and the reason it's there is because if you don't put it here, the compiler can trivially get rid of the binding P. But here, the optimizer moves these, there are several uses of P, and it gets replaced by information about this. But the optimizer doesn't figure that early enough to actually eliminate this binding.
I see.
But by adding these extra references here, we come up with something that we defeat the optimization over here so that this one can be consistent with it.
Interesting.
Yeah.
Cool.
And of course, if the optimizer improves so that it can eliminate them, it'll just eliminate them in both.
Great. Well, I think I'm done with the questions that I have.
Okay.
Let me just pause for just a moment to see if any more questions come in before we close out. Well, I have to say that I've greatly enjoyed this. This is something that I've always been very curious about, and as you mentioned before in the Unresolver, I worked with Blake for a while on that, and that was always interesting to learn about these things, and this has definitely been informative for me. So thank you so much for your time, and just as an announcement for everybody, we do plan on doing more Inside Racket seminars. We could obviously talk to Matthew about all sorts of things that we're curious about that he knows about every week for a very long time, but we're going to be careful with his time and only have Matthew every once in a while. Next up, we don't have an announcement, but it would be nice if people could email what they're interested in. I personally have a few ideas that I'm going to run by some people. And thank you again, Matthew.
Thanks.
Okay, great. Well, we'll see you on the mailing list. Bye-bye.
Okay, bye.